Amen. I appreciate Brother Mark playing that for us. It's good to see you. I appreciate each one of you joining us today. I hope it won't be long till we'll get to be meeting again together in our church. I miss that very much. You'll be opening your Bible to the book of 2 Corinthians, chapter number 4. I'll be reading verses 1 through 18. And we're going to try to preach to you what God's laid on our heart. I thought I was going to be preaching on a subject dealing with the week after Easter, but God has directed me to this scripture for this week. But it's good to see you, and I hope everybody's had a good week. And be finding 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 1, and then after this song, we'll get into the message. God bless you. Corinthians chapter 4, and we will start reading in verse number 1, But then I'm going to key in on verse 17 and 18. And I'll tell you more about that when we get down to it. But let's read God's word. The Bible says, "Therefore, seeing we have this ministry, as we have received mercy, we faint not, but have renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness, nor handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth." And that's something we're not hearing a lot of, I'm afraid, today. But we're wanting to not walk in craftiness nor handle the word of God deceitfully, but we want to manifest the truth. It goes on and says, "Commending ourselves to every man's conscience in the sight of God." And then it says, "But if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. For we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, hath shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. We are troubled on every side." This is the state of our world right now. "Yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. We're persecuted, but not forsaken. We're cast down, but not destroyed. Always bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our body. For we which live are always delivered unto death for Jesus' sake, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our mortal flesh. So then, death worketh in us, but life in you. We, having the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, I believed, and therefore have I spoken. We also believe, and therefore speak, knowing that he which raised up the Lord Jesus shall raise up us also by Jesus, and present us with you. For all things are for your sakes, that the abundant grace might through the thanksgiving of many redound to the glory of God. For which cause we faint not, but though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day." Now, verse 17, 18, this is where I'm going to be taking my text from today. Says, "For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more an exceeding and external and eternal weight of glory, while we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal." Friend, I'm going to tell you, I talked to several people this week. I've talked to people that are scared to death. They're saying, what's going to become of this coronavirus? I said, I don't know. I don't know what the future holds, but praise God, I know who holds the future. And I know where my future lies. It lies with the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, I want you to notice, I've talked with several people in our church has had some serious surgeries, and none of it is pertaining to the coronavirus. You see, there are a lot of things worse than the virus that the world is in a panic about. And friend, I'll tell you something. I told somebody this week that it's not the virus we need to be afraid of. It's not being in the hospital with that sickness that we need to worry about. What we need to worry about is if we die, or if you die with that virus, then friend, you're going to spend an eternity in hell if you're not born again, if you're not saved. So that is something that we're going to have to really deal with. Now, you know, there's a lot of, like I said, a lot of people face surgeries this week. A lot of people dealing with uncertain treatments that they're having to go through for different decisions. But you know, it reminded me of an old song that's in the Redback Hymnal. I think it's in the hymnal. I don't know. It may not be. But it says, "Where could I go?" Listen to the words of this song. It says, "Where could I go, living below in this old sinful world, hardly a comfort can afford, striving along to face temptation sore?" Oh, there, let me tell you. "Where could I go but to the Lord? Where could I go, oh, where could I go, seeking a refuge for my soul, needing a friend to help me in the end? Where could I go but to the Lord?" It goes on, says, "Neighbors are kind. I love them, every one. We get along with sweet accord. But when my soul needs manna from above," it means when my soul needs help, "where can I go but to the Lord?" Friend, I'm glad that we have a place that we can go to. I'm glad we have a shelter. I'm glad we have a God that cares. He's not on vacation. He's not sick. He's not hurting. You see, if he was sick, they would let me know, because I'm the next of kin. Friend, he is my heavenly Father. And I believe they'd let me know if something was wrong with him or if something was going on. But there's 3 points that I've got in the message today. Number one that I see in this scripture is our liberty. You see, starts off with the word therefore. The verse 1 says therefore. And so whenever you see the word therefore in the Word of God, you look to see what it's there for. So I did. And that means you go back up to chapter 3. And you start reading in verse 12 and listen to what it says. He says, "Seeing then that we have such hope," praise God, I'm glad we've got a hope, "we use great plainness of speech, and not as Moses, which put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is abolished, but their minds were blinded. For until this day remaineth the same veil undertaken away in the reading of the Old Testament, which veil is done away in Christ. But even unto this day, when Moses is read, the veil is upon the heart. Nevertheless, when it shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. Now the Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass of the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image for glory, from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord." You see, I'm glad that our hope and our help and our home does not rest in this world. I'm glad that we've got a heavenly Father that cares about us and loves us. And the devil's fighting this message today because God wants us to have some help in this time of trouble. We are in a crisis. We are in something that we've never seen before, never had to deal with. And there's a lot that we're scared. We're not being told the truth. We feel like that we're being herded around like a bunch of cattle. You remember back during the Holocaust, me and my wife was talking this week, why in the world would those Jews let them, herd them up, and put them in these buildings and these gas chambers and not put up a fight? I don't know. But I do know this. We've got a God in heaven that cares for us. And honey, it may come down to a time where we're going to have to stand for what we believe. I don't like the government telling me what I got to do. I don't like them telling me I can't go to church. I don't like them telling me I can't go to the store. I don't like them insinuating that we don't have enough sense to get out of the rain. Honey, I'll tell you something. God is greater than any government power in this world. And I trust Him. You see, we've got a liberty that this world does not know. You see, people are scared to death. We talk to people, my wife talks to people all the time that are at the hospital, and she said they're scared to death and they're worried to death. And she tells them, said, honey, you don't need to worry about this sickness. What you need to worry about is where you're going to go after you die. You see, that's the greatest thing. And then point number two, I see our light affliction. Verse 17 starts off and says, for our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we look not on the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. And friend, I titled this message from verse number 17, where it says, for our light affliction, which is but for a moment. You see, the title of my message today is But for a Moment. Friend, I want to tell you, this too is going to pass one day. It's going to pass, and we're going to wonder what happened. And I believe the Lord is soon returning. But we've got a light of, the Bible says it's a light affliction. You see, we have this world that we've got to contend with and problems that we've got to contend with. But I'll tell you something, there are a lot of things worse than that coronavirus. I mean, there are a lot of things that we're going to have to put up with that we're going to see that we have to deal with. And God, the same God that brought us through all of our other troubles, the one that was with me when we was going through things with my daughter and things, the same God that was with us then is with us now. Praise God, it's a light affliction. The Bible says, our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. And then he goes on in verse 18, says, while we look not at the things which are seen. You see, if we get our eyes on the things of this world, and the devil gets our mind wrapped up in that and gets us off of the Word of God. I told somebody, I think I put it on Facebook this week. If you want your heart settled, quit listening to the news. I don't listen to the news. I want to challenge you. Whatever time you use to listen to the news, use that same time to read and study your Bible. You see, our Bible is more accurate than any newspaper in this world. And when we can look to that, I can see where I came from. I can see where I'm at. And I can see where I'm headed. That's why I'm not afraid of anything. Whatever the Lord chooses to put me through, I just pray God gives me the grace to accept it and to go on with it, because the Bible said here it's a light affliction. And then point number three, and I'll wind it up. I see our Lord in this passage of Scripture. Thank God we've got a Lord. And verse 18 says, while we look not on the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen, for the things which are not seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Praise God. Hallelujah. I'm glad that he's the one that's got my future in his hand. You see, the thing I want you to know is our God cannot fail. Never, ever, 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 not even stumble. Our God will never fail. Deuteronomy, I wrote down a few verses. Deuteronomy 31:8 says, and the Lord, he it is that doth go before thee. He will be with thee. He will not fail thee, neither forsake thee. Fear not, neither be dismayed. Hallelujah goes right there. It wasn't in the text, but I put a hallelujah right there in my notes. Deuteronomy 31:6 says, be strong and of good courage. Fear not, nor be afraid of them. For the Lord thy God, he it is that doth go with thee. He will not fail thee, nor forsake thee. Praise God. I'm glad we've got a help. I'm glad we've got a God that loves us. Hebrews 13:5 says, "Let not your conversation be without covetousness, and be content with such things as you have, for he has said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee." You know, we've gone into grocery stores and we've gone into different stores, and the shelves look like an atomic bomb had gone off and there was no food. But I want to tell you something. Every time that I've gone into a grocery store and I needed something, there may not have been an abundance there, but I never walked out of that store without what I was going after. You see, I've always said this, and I guess I'll die saying this. I believe if there's one soda cracker left in Paulding County, Georgia, and that's all we've got to eat, I got enough faith and enough trust to believe that my God shall supply all of my needs according to his glory, which is in Christ Jesus. I tell you, if this just comes down to one soda cracker in Paulding County, you better bet Leonard Chambers is going to be on one corner of that thing just to gnaw in a way. I'm just glad that Jesus loves me. Now, Isaiah 41, now you can read verses 10 through 13, but I want to read verse 10. It says, "Fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God." And listen to this. "I will strengthen thee. Yeah, I will help thee. Yeah, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness." I'm glad we've got, there was so much scripture that I could have put down. But then 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 7, one of my favorite scriptures says, "Casting all your care upon him." Why? "Because he careth for you." Praise his holy name. Hebrews 13, you can read verse 5 and 6. "Let your conversation be without covetousness, and be content with such things." I think I've already read this one, but it's worth reading again. "And be content with such things you have, for he has said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee." Praise his holy name. And then Matthew 28:20 says, "Teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen." Now, I don't know how long this trouble we're in, this pandemic, don't know how long it's going to last, but I want you to know we serve a God that's bigger than whatever it does. We serve a God that's able to do exceeding abundant above all we ever ask or think. Philippians 4, "Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving." He said, "Let our request be made known." You see, 2 Timothy verse 1, chapter 1, verse 7, and I'll close with this verse. "For God hath not given us," that's you and me that are saved by the grace of God, "the spirit of fear, but of power." Where does that power come from? It comes from Almighty God. "And of love." Where's that love come from? That love, he loved us when we didn't have sense enough to love ourselves. Praise God. "God hath not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of a love and of a sound mind." Somebody asked me the other day, said, "Brother Leonard, did that tornado or that storm, what'd y'all do during that?" I said, "I slept like a baby." I believe that the Bible says that the clouds are the dust of his feet and the thunder is the voice of God. Whenever I hear it thundering, I say, well, God's talking today and God's walking around. Hebrews 4:16 tells us, "Let us therefore," the reason, because all I've said and all the scripture that I've read, he said, "Let us therefore come boldly under the throne of grace, that we obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need." Thank God we've got a God that cares and that loves us. And I'm thankful that, like the song says, he walks with me and he talks with me and he tells me I'm his own. Thank you for tuning in with us today. And I want to thank Josh and Mark for taking care of the video, and we'll see how it turns out tomorrow. God bless you. I'm going to go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, for this day. Thank you for your many blessings. Lord, we thank you. I thank you for meeting with me in this little room. I pray, God, that you'll take the message and put it where it needs to go. I pray you'd encourage your people. Lord, I thank you for being the pastor of Central Baptist Church. And God, I pray for each one of them, Lord, those in the hospitals and we can't go see them. Lord, I pray for them. Pray, God, you just pour them out a special blessing today. God, I pray you go with us now. And whatever you do, we'll thank you and praise you, because we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. God bless you until Wednesday at 6 o'clock.